In the last couple of lectures, we had looked at various kinds of adders, so how they can be designed, implemented, and some, you can say, comparative study among them. So in this lecture, first we shall be looking at some aspect about the process of addition which you have not talked about yet, namely generating some so-called conditional flags, and then we shall be moving on to design of multipliers. Okay, so in this lecture we shall be starting with generating the status flags. Now, what is a status flag? Now, many conventional processors, if you look at the instruction set or if you look at the instruction set architecture, you will find that they have some specific condition flags like sign flag, zero flag, overflow flag, and so on. These flags are automatically set as a result of some arithmetic or logic operations. Like for example, you can do an addition. After addition, you can compare whether the result is negative or positive. This you can do by checking whether the sign flag is 0 or 1, or you can check if the result is 0. This you can do by checking whether the 0 flag is 0 or 1. So, the concept of condition flags is this. There are a set of flip flops or 1 bit registers, you can say, they are the flags. They are automatically set or reset depending on the result of some previous operation. So, after that, you can use a conditional branch instruction, for example, to check the status of the flag and take some decision accordingly. Okay, fine. So, here we shall be talking about 4 of the commonly used flags. There are several other flags also used in some machines. The zero flag tells whether the result is 0 or not. Normally, this flag is set by both arithmetic and logic operations. Sign flag tells whether the result is positive or negative. So, for 2's complement representation, a 0 will mean positive, 1 will mean negative. That means the most significant bit of the result is the same as the sign flag. And this sign flag is set for both arithmetic and logic operations typically. Carry, already we have seen adders, we have seen how carries are generated from one addition stage to another. This flag will tell whether there has been a carry out of the final or the most significant stage. And this carry information is used only for arithmetic operations. And lastly, there is a flag called overflow, which tells whether the result is too large to fit in the register after an operation or not, say used for arithmetic operations. Typically arithmetic addition and subtraction, sometimes also multiplication. Okay, so we will see these things one by one. So, generation of these flags is not difficult, rather easy. Let us consider a very simple typical scenario like this, where we have an arithmetic logic unit which takes as inputs from 2 registers A and B, and the result it is depositing into another register F. Let us assume all of them are n bit registers. Firstly, the zero flag can be very easily generated by using a single n input NOR gate. So, what is a NOR gate? The output of a NOR gate will be 1 if all the inputs are 0. So, if all the bits of the result are 0, the output NOR gate will be 1, that will indicate the zero flag. So, actually the circuit will be like this. You have a large NOR gate. So, the inputs from the result register F are fed here, and the output you are feeding to a flip flop. This is a Z flip flop, 0 flip flop, that is called as the input Q. So, this will be loaded by some control signal, and once loaded, this 0 flag will be available. Okay, it is simple, just an OR gate. Similarly, the sign flag can be generated directly from the most significant bit of the result. Just you take this Fn minus 1, you feed it to a S flip flop. That will be your S flag register, very simple. So, generating of the sign flag is also very easy. Carry flag, well, you know that for addition subtraction, you have already seen that there is already a carry out signal coming out of the adder. So, this ALU will also be having a carry out signal. That carry out signal will be directly going into the C flag flip flop. This you can load directly, right. So, this is how you can generate carry. Now, talking about overflow, you see here we are talking about overflow during additions and subtractions. See, overflow can occur during addition only when the sign of the two operands are the same. Now, if one of the number is positive and the other number is negative, you can never have overflow. Let me take an example. Let's take a very simple example of a 4-bit representation, 2's complement. So, in 4-bit, what are the maximum numbers I can represent? When in the positive side, I can represent maximum 0, 1, 1, which means plus 7. In the negative side, I can represent 1, 0, 0, 0, which means minus 8. So, let us say I am adding plus 5 and plus 4. Let us say I am adding these two numbers. Plus 5 will be 0101, plus 4 will be 0100. Now, quite naturally, the sum of the numbers will not fit in 4 bits because maximum you can store is 7. So, let us see what happens after addition. 1, 0, 0 with a carry of 1, 1. So, my result is 1001. So, one observation is the sign of my numbers were positive, but the result has become negative. Same thing, you look for two negative numbers, same thing will happen. Let us take minus 5 and minus 4, let us say. Minus 5 will be 1, 0, 1, 1, this is minus 5, minus 4 will be 1, 1, 0, 0. Just add them up, 1, 1, 1, 0 with a carry of 1. Now, here also you see that your sign bit of your original numbers were 1 and 0, but the sign bit of the result has become different, right. These are the conditions for overflow detection. So, the condition is sign of the result becomes different from the sign of the operands. So, we can write down in terms of expression like this, sign of the two numbers a n minus 1 b n minus 1, suppose they are 1, 1. But f n minus 1 is 0, or a n minus 1 bar b n minus 1 bar, they are 0, 0, but this is 1. And this expression can be simplified like this also. You simply take an XOR of f n minus 1 and the final carry out, they will actually mean the same thing. So, either way, whichever is easier to implement, you can implement the overflow flag. Now, one thing we are not considering overflow for division operation at present, because division or multiplication, let us say, because in multiplication, normally when you add 2 n bit numbers, the product is stored in a 2 n bit register, double the size. So, there can never be an overflow there. So, for that purpose, for the time being, we are assuming that overflow is important only for addition and subtraction, not for multiplication. Now, again talking of the flag register, the MIPS architecture that we have been studying does not have any status flags at all. Why? Because the instruction set and the architecture of MIPS was designed primarily for very efficient pipeline implementations. Now, in a pipeline, you will be studying this in much more detail later. that when there are several instructions which are running in a pipeline, they are in various stages of execution. Now, if there is a single set of flag register, there can be confusion. The first register may be setting the zero flag, the second register may also be trying to set the zero flag, so there can be some confusion. So, for a pipeline implementation, existence of the flags creates something called side effects which are undesirable. So, MIPS uses an entirely different philosophy. They do not use any status flags, rather they temporarily store flag information in a general purpose register. I am showing a simple example. There is an instruction called set less than. Set less than, what it does, it will check if S1 is less than S2 or not, these two registers. If they are less, S1 is less than S2, then the target register will be set to 1. Otherwise, this target register will be set to 0. So, you are storing either a 0 or a 1 in the target register, so as if the whole target register you are using as a flag, something like that. Okay? And immediately after that, you can have an instruction like a conditional branch, branch if equal T0 with 0, you are checking whether the result is 0 or not. 0 means this was not less than, right? Then you jump to a label. So, earlier what you would do? Earlier you would do branch if not 0, jump to a label. But now since we do not have a flag register, we have to use one of these set instructions first, then use a conditional branch instruction checking the value of the target register, whether it is 0 or non-zero. Okay? Fine. Let us now come to multiplication. Talking about multiplication of unsigned numbers, the first thing is that the amount of hardware required for multiplication is substantially greater as compared to addition. Multiplication of two n bit numbers can generate a 2 n bit product. Let us look at an example to illustrate it. So, we are following a method which is very similar to the pen and pencil method we are familiar with. So, when we multiply two numbers using the so called decimal number system, we follow a very similar approach. So, what we do? Let us say this is our multiplicand, this is our multiplier, all expressed in binary. They are unsigned numbers, not 2's complement. So, 1010 means 10, 1101 means 13. So, I check the first digit of the multiplier. If it, so normal multiplication, what we do? We multiply this by this. We do the same thing. Multiply 1 by this. We get 1010. Then shift 1 plus light left. Multiply 0 with this. We get 0000. Multiply 1 with this, shift. Multiply 1 with this, shift. This. Then finally, you add all the bits up. 0, 1, 0, 1, 1 is 0 with a carry of 1, 0 with a carry of 1, 0 with a carry of 1, 0 with a carry of 1. So, the product is 130, you see that the product requires 8 bits. So, this one example shows that when you multiply 2 4 bit numbers, your result may become double of that, 8 bits. So, the product can be 2 n bits. And this method of addition is called shift and add. So, we do repeated additions of shifted versions of the multiplication, because here we are only multiplying by 1 or 0. So, 1 means the same multiplicand will be appearing 1010, 1010, 1010 after various number of shiftings. So, either we can write down all these so called partial products, you can say, and then add them up together, or we can continuously go on adding as the next one is generated. That is also possible. Okay? So, in a general case, I am just writing this in a very general term, this AIs and BIs can be 0 or 1. So, B0, it can be 0 or 1, is multiplied to all these 4 bits. B0 into A0, B0 into A1, B0 into A2, B0 into A3. Similarly, B1, B1 A0, B1 A1, B1 A2, B3 A3. Similarly, with B2, with B3. This is exactly what we are doing. Now, this each of these product terms that I have shown here, this is called a partial product. Now, for adding two 4-bit numbers, if you can just check, there are 16 partial products. So, for multiplying two n-bit numbers, there will be n square partial products, right? To generate every partial product, you need just an AND gate. Just you AND the corresponding bits, you get this partial product, right? So, for multiplying two n-bit numbers, for generating all the partial products, you will be needing n square such AND gates, and then you will have to add them up in a suitable way. You will be needing a complex adder circuit to add so many partial products together. Okay. So, you need a lot of hardware. This is what I wanted to say. So, just from this basic principle, let us try to come up with a simple hardware implementation of an adder. This is called a combinational array multiplier. So, what we are doing? We are using something called a multiplication cell. So, whatever the process we have just now shown here, shift and add, generating the partial products, we are directly trying to map it in hardware. How we are doing? We are using an array of cells like this, many cells. Each of these cells will look like this. So, let us first explain this first. So, we are not waiting till the end to add all the partial products. We are adding the partial product at every stage. Now, what does this indicate? This AND gate which is shown, this generates the partial product. And this full adder will be adding this partial product with another partial product coming from the previous stage after shifting. And this full adder will be getting a carry input, it will be generating a carry output, and this will be generating a sum. And it will be clear if you see the schematic diagram how it is done. Here for 4 by 4 multiplication I am showing, there will be 16 such cells. So, diagonally from the right, the bits of the multiplicands are coming, M0, M1, M2, M3. That means here, from here. And that same bit is also coming here, going to the next stage. So, this M0 is also going to the next stage, M1 is also going to the next stage, M2 and M3. And on the from the other side, the quotient bits are applied, Q0, Q1, Q2, Q3. It is from this side. So, the quotient and the multiplier, if you just AND them, you will be getting the partial product. So, that partial products are getting added, you have a ripple carry adder. This adder, full adders are all connected in cascade. So, you have a ripple carry adder. So, initially the input is, one input is 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. The first partial product is getting added to 0, you get the partial product here. Next one, so the way this multiplier is designed, there is automatically a 1 bit left shift, you can see. Next stage is computing the partial products, then adding to the previous one. Next one is computing next partial product after again 1 bit shift, adding to the previous one. In this way it goes on. So, finally at the end, whatever you get will be the product. See, P0 will be generated here, P1 here, P2 here. Then P3, P4, P5, P6, P7. Okay. This is how you can also see from here, because the first bits are generated earlier. The last bits will be generated together at the last stage. The same thing is happening here. So, this method is very simple. Whatever you are doing by hand, you have directly mapped it to hardware. But the problem is that this kind of a multiplier is extremely inefficient, it requires extremely large amount of hardware. That means you need n square such cells. But the advantage is that it is much faster as compared to the other multiplication methods that we will see. That will be some kind of sequential multiplication method that will be seen. Fine. So, we have seen the multiplication method which is called combinational array multiplier. So, it is a combinational circuit. I apply my multiplier, apply my quotient. So, after some delays, my result will be generated. Now, we look at some multiplication methods which will be requiring much less amount of hardware, but will be sequential in nature. Means you will have to run the circuit for several clock cycles to complete the multiplication. Okay? So, let us look at unsigned sequential multiplication first. So, exactly what we have said is that requires much less hardware, but requires several clock cycles. Much less hardware means what? Earlier, for combinational array multiplier, we are using n square cells. So, the hardware complexity was order n square. But here, we are saying we would be needing some hardware which will be proportional to the number of bits being multiplied. And also, the time required will also be order n, proportional to n. Now, in the hand multiplication step, what we have seen? We have seen that if the ith bit of the multiplier is 1, we shift the multiplicand by 1 bit position and add to the partial product. Like I am just showing you an example here. Let us multiply 0 1 0 1 with 1 0 1 1. First with this 1 I multiply this, it becomes 0 1 0 1. Then with this 1 I multiply with 1 shift. 0, 1, 0, 1, I immediately add them. Okay, I immediately add them. Then comes this 0, 0 means you again shift and add 0, just immediately add them. Last one, 0, 1, 0, 1, just again another shift, 0, 1, 1, 0. This is your final product. So, you are shifting the multiplicand by variable amount at every step. You are shifting here, shifting again here, shifting again here. But the relative position of the partial product you are not changing. This bit positions are kept in the same position. But for actual implementation, we will be doing something else. Instead of doing this, we will be making a small change. So, we do not shift the multiplicand, we will keep the position fixed. Rather, the partial product will be shifting right at every step. Like here, we are keeping the partial product same and shifting the multiplicand left every step. What we are saying, we will keep the multiplicand in the same place, partial product will be shifting right. So, means these two are equivalent. So, either you keep this in the same place and shift this left, or keep this in the same place and shift this right. So, we are following the second approach because it is easier to implement in hardware, right. Okay. This shift and add multiplication, let us look at it. First, we talk about the overall steps in the form of a flowchart as shown here. See, here the idea is as follows. We are computing something like a partial product. You see, we are using some registers A, M and Q. Normally, these registers A and Q, they are considered together. Initially, A will be loaded with all zeros and Q will be loaded with whatever the quotient is, right? And we will be shifting this to the right, and whenever we have to just add the multiplicand, we will be adding it here. The M will be adding to this position, and this whole thing will be shifting right. this will be the principle we'll be following. Okay, so you see this. So we start by initializing this A register to 0, C is a carry bit to 0, count is the number of times we will be looping for n, m is multiplicand, q is multiply. So I am assuming m and q are both n bit multiply, n bit registers. A is a n bit temporary register initialized to 0 and C is the carry out from an adder. So what we do, we check the last bit of the quotient q0. So if it is 1, we have to add. If it is 0, we are adding a 0, right, in the shift and add method. Let us look at this. So you look at the last bit q0. So if the q0 bit is 1, you add the multiplicand to A, just like as we have seen, we are adding the multiplicand to A. If the q0 bit is 0, we are adding 0 to A, right. And after adding what I told here, after adding, we will be shifting right A and Q. Not only A and Q, after adding, there will be a carry which will be coming here. This will be C. So C, A, Q together will be shifting right, right. So we are doing exactly that. We are doing an arithmetic shift right C, A, Q, and we are decrementing the count by 1. We are checking whether count is 0 or not. If it is not 0, we go back. If it is 0, we stop, right. This is the method. So I am illustrating with the help of an example. Let us consider two 5 bit numbers, 10 and 13. 10 in 5 bits is this, 13 in 5 bits is this. So the product is expected to be 130. So initially my A is 0, Q contains the quotient 0 1 0 1 0 0 1, and the carry bit is 0. So what I do, I check whether Q is 0 or 1. I see it is 1. So I have to add multiplicand m to this. So I add, I do A equal to A plus m. So A becomes, it was 0, A will become 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, and I do a right shift. There is no carry, I do a right shift. See, after right shift what happens? The quotient, the last bit you have already seen. After right shift, the next bit comes here. So I will be inspecting the next bit after that, this bit, okay, because I have to check the bits one by one, right. So again I check this, this is 0, so now we will have to add 0. Add 0, so there is no change in A, no change, and again we do a shift right. Again do a shift right, so the next bit comes here, next bit of the quotient comes here. 1, you add m again to it, so 0 1 0 1 0 plus 0 0 0 1 0, it becomes 0 1 1 0 0. This you can check. And you do, again you do a shift, so this one comes here finally. So you check this, so you again add m to this 0 0 1 1 0, it becomes 1 0 0 0 0. So again do a shift, last time you check this bit, the last bit 0, so you add 0, no change, and shift. This is your final result, final product. So you see, the quotient which I had loaded initially in this register has slowly shifted out and is replaced by the product finally. So at the end, I had made 5 shifts. So the quotient bits are all, they have gone out. So the result does not contain the quotient bits anymore. So after addition, shifting, addition, shifting, addition, shifting, they will slowly fill up this whole 10-bit register, right. This is the product. Now in this example, the carry bit was never 1. Let us take another example where the carry bit can be 1. Let us say we multiply 29 and 21, these are the two numbers, the product is supposed to be 609, this. Same way, we look at 1, you add the multiplicand 11101, then do a right shift, next bit is 0. So you add 0, no change, then do a right shift, 1. So 00111 will be added to 11101. This will be generating this product with a carry. This you can check. So after shift, this carry will get shifted in here, right? Then you check again the next bit, 0, no addition, that means you are adding 0, no change. Again shift, next bit is 1, the last bit. You again add M to it, you again get a carry out of 1. Again shift right, this 1 will again go in, and this will be your last and final result, 609. Okay. So this is how the basic shift and add multiplication works. Now, talking about the hardware circuit for it, it is very simple. So what we shown in the example, we need exactly that. We need a register for A, we need a register for Q, we need a carry flip-flop, and they will be connected as a shift register. We need an adder with one of the inputs coming from M and the other inputs either coming from the multiplicand or the 0. And there will, these are all n-bit registers, A, Q and M. The last bit of Q is Q0, and there will be a control unit which will be checking Q0 at every step and will be selecting the multiplexer appropriately. Either it is selecting 0 or M, and also it will be generating control signal for the other part. So means after addition, the shifting will be going on. It will keep track of how many times it will be repeating. So control unit will be doing that, right? So the data path, as you can see, is very simple. Other than the registers, you need just an adder and a multiplexer and just one flip flop for carry. So with this, we come to the end of this lecture. In the next lecture, we shall be looking at some other methods of multiplication, particularly signed multiplication, how we can multiply to signed numbers and some improvements therein. Thank you.